Hello.
Hi, welcome to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. With me today is my co-host, Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. Welcome, Nick.
Thank you, Mark. Always good to be back.
And why don't you tell us who your special guest is today?
So today I am super pumped up to have a great guest from the Highland Friendship Club. Her name is Holly Kampa, and she's going to come on and tell us a little bit more about what HFC has going on and how people can be more involved.
Well, that sounds good. Well, my guest today is Jennifer Sutch, in charge of development at Shriners Twin Cities, or Shriners Hospital. Also, they just celebrated in March their 100th anniversary, which is a big milestone for them. Also, on June 2nd, they're having a Believe and Achieve dinner and some other things going on. So in just a moment or two, we'll be talking to her. So we have all that more coming up today, next on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. With me now is Trevor Turner from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. And he has been really great about doing our legislative update during this session that we've had for the House and Senate and Capitol. So Trevor, welcome to the show. And you might want to bring us up to date on what has really been going on in the House and Senate and Capitol. So it's all yours.
Thank you, Mark, and thanks for having me back.
You're welcome.
So this week, we are really kind of in a hurry up and wait period of the legislative session. We have exactly 2 weeks to go before the end of session on May 22nd. And so all the conference committee hearings are happening right now with all the different omnibus bills that are—
Everyone that except ours.
Yeah, exactly. Except for transportation.
Yeah.
But they are planning to meet tomorrow, so we'll see about that one. But, you know, there has been some great things that have happened since I last spoke to you. You know, last Friday, the governor signed the Democracy for the People Act, which has strengthened voters' protections and includes things like automatic voter registration, just making it easier to vote. So we'll be really interested to see how the 2024 election goes now that we have this law on the books, and see if that really increases the voter turnout. And also, since the last time I was on, the legislature passed and the governor signed the conversion therapy ban, the trans refuge bill, and the abortion protection bill. So these are things that are making national news for Minnesota. So Minnesota is getting a lot of national recognition for really kind of leading the way on some of these legislative priorities. And then, speaking of national news as well, the legislature also passed the marijuana legalization bill, but that has to be reconciled in conference committee, and so before it has a final vote for it to be fully legal in Minnesota, but that's almost certainly going to happen.
Right.
And then today, the House is voting on the paid family leave bill. That actually is expected to pass, and will probably, by the time this airs, we'll already know whether that passes or not. But that's planned for this afternoon. But the conference committees, there's for agriculture, commerce, veterans, and legacy, they have already agreed and came up with a final bill. And so those will be sent to the House and the Senate to be voted on and passed. And so those will be done. The legacy committee, the legacy conference omnibus bill has about $250,000 for the Minnesota Council on Disability for to commemorate our 50th anniversary. So that's kind of really great for us, and to be able to celebrate the last 50 years that in disability advocacy we've had in the state.
Okay.
We'll be doing a lot of stuff at the state fair this year, and also collecting stories and all that kind of thing, and really just trying to celebrate the last 50 years of disability advocacy and all the Minnesotans with disabilities who have really contributed to making this a better place for people with disabilities.
In the House, I wanted to say that Leanne Lilly did a really, I think, a nice job on the Legacy Committee this session, and we owe a lot to him, and he's from North St. Paul, and I just want to tell him thanks for the job that I think he did, and he was good to the Minnesota Council on Disabilities, and that's important to me, so There you
absolutely,
go.
Absolutely, yeah. He's been absolutely great. He and Senator Herr have worked really well together and have gotten the conference committee done for the legacy omnibus bill, one of the first to be done this session. So they worked really well together this year. Don't want to count our chickens before they hatch, but in the Senate and the House Human Services omnibus bill, we also have a significant budget increase for our council for us to provide a lot more programming and services for Minnesotans with disabilities. Mm-hmm. I believe regardless of which version they go with, the House version or the Senate, it'll basically double our budget. And so the Senate and the House have really decided to invest in people with disabilities, not just in our own council, but also in a lot of different services and programming and all that kind of stuff with DHS and things like that. And so this is going to be a really transformational legislative session for people with disabilities.
Well, good for us. Hey, and I got a couple minutes left, so let's do anything I might have missed while we're doing this.
I think the most important thing is just to keep following the conference committee. We only have 2 weeks left, so we should see a lot of the movement this week. And you know, it's typically on a legislative session, the last weekend is a very busy weekend, and it's packed, and people are working from 6 o'clock in the morning till midnight, trying to pass bills. But this year's been a little bit different. They're actually really ahead of schedule.
Yeah, I think from the get-go, it started out a lot faster than it normally does.
It really did.
The momentum never really slowed down, and I think therein lies the difference. And
exactly. That's why we call it a hurry up and wait session.
That's right. Because, you know, like today, it's a hurry up and wait, yeah.
But for government affairs and lobbyist specialists like me, you know, this couple weeks have been kind of anxiety driven because, you know, we can't really do much at this point. It's really in the hands of the legislators. So really just get waiting around and hoping for good news.
That's exactly right. All right, Trevor. Well, thanks for the job you're doing down there and the job you did for us. And we'll talk to you again next time on Disability Viewpoints. We'll be right back.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm your co-host, Nick Wilkie. I work for the Center for Independent Living, and occasionally I have a great opportunity to interview some great organizations. With me today is Holly Kampa. Holly works for the Highland Friendship Club, and I'm so overjoyed to have Holly on. She's gonna tell us a little bit more about what HFC has to offer. So with that, Holly, thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
It's good to be with you today. Can you tell our viewers a little bit more about how HFC got started?
Absolutely, yeah. HFC was founded in 2002 by two moms named Pat and Rose that lived in the Highland Park community in St. Paul, hence Highland Friendship Club. And they both had teenage sons who are kind of around that 14-year-old age that have intellectual and developmental disabilities. And they saw a major gap in resources for their sons in the categories of like friendships and social opportunities and all of that kind of stuff. So, you know, by the time you get to kind of late middle school, even early middle school, you kind of start to see those social interactions drop off, and the birthday parties are no longer, everyone in the class is invited. People are starting to form social groups, and whether it's between or whether it's with sports or with theater groups or whatever it is. And so they just kind of saw those social interactions drop off, and they saw that gap in opportunity, and they wanted to fill it. So that's how Highland Friendship Club was born.
That's awesome. And that's a while ago now.
Oh, yeah. 21 years.
That's super, super cool.
Yeah.
So with that being said, Holly, any events coming up that you want to mention?
Yep. So just the very general structure of HFC is we hold over 30 events per week. Sometimes we get pretty close to that 40 events a week mark. And, you know, once in a while we have these big extraordinary events that you'd kind of think of when you think of events. But a lot of our events are small 1 hour things. Most of our events run on somewhat of a regular basis. So whether it's weekly, bi-weekly, monthly, we have fitness classes that run like 3 times per week or 2 times per week. And so we offer those events week after week.
Okay.
We are super excited because our summer schedule just came out, and so kind of right after Memorial Day, we'll get kicked off with that summer schedule, and we've got some cool new events. We've got a lion dancing class that we're going to be holding this summer. We've got a new in-person class.
Awesome.
It's a boot camp. So we've got all these cool things.
Okay.
We're finally getting back to doing some in-person karaoke. We've been doing karaoke online for quite a while, and we'll still have an online karaoke, but we're also able to offer it in person this semester. And so, you know,
awesome.
We've got all these events from all these different categories under the sun, and we're excited to be able to keep expanding those opportunities and having a lot of fun in the process.
That's awesome, Holly. How does somebody qualify
for
different services and programs?
Yeah. So we don't have any official qualifications. No one has to like have a doctor's note or anything like that. But just very generally, we are available to anybody ages 13 plus in the community who have disabilities. The largest majority of our individuals, or we call them members. Members
okay.
is kind of a very loose word. Membership is free per se.
Okay.
They have disabilities, and all they have to do is kind of show interest in our programs and sign up for our programs, and that's it. So we don't have any official qualification process. It's all very self laid out. If an individual has a disability and they want to connect with others with disabilities, that's the route to get there.
That's awesome. That's very similar to the independent living philosophy.
Yeah.
You know, do you have a desire to make choices? Do you have a desire to do new things?
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love that. So along those lines, being social unites everyone. Can you talk a little bit more about that intersection?
Oh yeah, yes. Being social certainly unites people. I mean, I think about in my life outside of work, I wanna, you know, hang out with my friends and see people that maybe I don't get to see too often, or people who I do see often but aren't part of like necessarily my day-to-day living. It's not someone who I'd have to see, like I would see my roommate or whatever else. But seeing people outside is always exciting, and people with disabilities have the exact same desire as everybody else does.
Yep.
We want to connect with friends. We want to make new friends. We want to meet new people. We want to learn about cool things. We want to learn about people. We want to hear what people are up to. As individuals at HFC connect with one another, they're also able to connect with things outside of HFC, Special Olympics, all of those kinds of things. And so you just, at HFC, you see those friendships being formed between all kinds of people who probably never would have met each other if it wasn't for HFC.
Awesome. Would you say that also helps connect supports of members?
Yeah. Absolutely, yeah. You know, a lot of our classes have kind of different goals. I mean, we've got fitness classes, we have skill building classes, we have purely social classes, and within classes specifically, we have a lot of skills that can be built, things that
right.
can be learned, healthy living, independent living,
right.
Fitness, all of those kinds of things. And so
yep.
they can work towards kind of individual goals in small ways at HFC classes. But being part of HFC also opens up the world to resources outside of HFC
right.
too, you know? So you attend
right.
an HFC event, and someone at the HFC event is talking about something super cool they were at last week, whether they were at a bocce ball tournament or, you know, something like that. And so people are able to learn about kind of those outside opportunities and get connected with them too.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I feel like I already know some of this, but I want to give you an opportunity to talk about what gets you so excited about the work that you do.
Yeah, you know, We have been super lucky kind of in these last months, especially as we're starting to get a little safer with COVID and everything, and we've been able to introduce more in-person classes. We have had a lot of new members join us at HFC, and I think one of the coolest things and one of the things that makes me most excited is seeing those new names on our class rosters. Mm-hmm. And when I'm able to stop into a class, I see these new people, I see them interacting with our members who have been around for a long time. I mean, we have members who have, you know, they've been around since the inception of HFC, right, which is fantastic, and obviously they've formed really close friendships, but it gets me super excited to see when new members come in and then they also start to form those connections, both with other new members who haven't been around HFC for long, but also the members who have been around for a long time. I mean, the goal is to continue growing that network and keep making new friends, and
awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome, that's super cool. Holly, would you be willing to share just a little bit of background about how you originally found out about HFC?
Yeah. So I have an older sister. Her name is Stephanie. She's 4 years older than me. And the minimum age for membership at the time was 14. It's dropped down to 13 now. And so back in 2010, Stephanie became a member of HFC. I was just 10 years old, and so for a few years there, I would kind of stop into events, you know, as my parents would bring me along in the car or whatever, so I would cool. get to meet people or see what was going on. But then by the time I got to like mid-high school age, when I was in NHS and all of that kind of stuff, I started volunteering at HFC, and I think a few months later, I became a staff member. Oh, so this sweet. Was all the way back in September 2017, so I That's was awesome. A staff member for a program staff member, so I was at the events helping facilitate. And then I took on the program manager role in October
That's
of
awesome.
2022. So it's been a long road, yes. but I mean it's been pretty cool to see the growth of HFC and yeah throughout all that time.
That's great, Holly. Do you have anything else that you'd like to share with our viewers?
Oh. Good question. I think it is perhaps important to highlight like the importance of friendships in people's lives. We've got all these super cool resources for individuals with disabilities. Metropolitan Center for Independent Living, of course, is one of them, and all these other resources. We were just talking about those resource fairs that both of our organizations have been attending, and you see a ton of people in living skills and in employment. But like Pat and Rose saw 20 years ago, there's certainly a gap in the ability for connections and friendships and all of that kind of right. stuff. And that's what we've seen at HFC, is that we have, you know, 180 to 200 people plus who really desire having those friendships and making those connections. And so the power of friendships and connections cannot be underestimated.
That sounds great. Well, Holly, I really want to thank you for coming on. You've provided so much great information. The final thing I wanted to ask is, where can people see action?
Yeah. You know, one of HFC's big things is being out in the community. And so as time goes on, we like to integrate ourselves more and more as we're able. And so we hope that you'll see us out at like the Landscape Arboretum or the Minnesota Zoo or the Como Zoo or random places that we go for events, but also like on social media. We've got Facebook and Instagram and all that kind of stuff where you can see what we're doing both at our office headquarters, but also out in the community and online. And so, yeah.
Super cool. And correct me if I'm wrong, Holly, but is the website, is it highlandfriendshipclub.org?
Org. Yep.
Okay.
You got it.
Excellent. So for our viewers, head to the website. The organization name, again, is Highland Friendship Club. Tons of opportunities that Holly mentioned. Holly, thanks so much for coming on, and I'll look forward to having you back.
Thank you.
And maybe we can get a member or two to come on next
Absolutely.
Time.
Absolutely. That'd
okay?
be fantastic.
All right. So for Disability Viewpoints, this is Nick Wilkie. I'd like to thank our viewers for watching. I'd like to thank Mark for having me on again. And take care, and we'll see you next time.
It's a tight labor market out there. Lots of great Minnesota businesses are struggling, not because they don't have enough business, but because they don't have enough workers to meet the demand.
If you run a business, maybe you've had the experience of hiring someone, training them, only to have them leave a short time later.
If you're looking for that competitive edge, qualified, skilled job applicants to build a workforce with employees who have a higher level of company loyalty, then connect with State Services for the Blind and Vocational Rehabilitation Services. We're a part of Minnesota's Department of Employment, Economic Development, and building a strong Minnesota economy that works for everyone.
At SSB and VRS, we work with our customers to build their skills and experience to succeed in careers in their chosen fields. We also work with employers on finding simple, cost-effective job accommodations where needed, and to connect businesses with qualified applicants. Our consultation services are free of charge to you. When our customers succeed, Minnesota businesses succeed.
We're building a stronger Minnesota, one opportunity at a time.
If you're an employer interested in knowing more, just give us a call at 651-539-2300.
At this time, we say hello to Jennifer Sutch from Shriners Children's in Woodbury, Minnesota. Hi, Jennifer. Welcome to the show. We got lots of things to talk about today. And first of all, happy 100th anniversary to Shriners Children's, 100 years anniversary this year. And also, we're having our Believe and Achieve dinner on June 2nd down at the Depot in Minneapolis, and we're all excited about that. And so give me an update of what's been happening over there at Shriners Children's, and let's take it away.
All right. Well, thanks, Mark. Thanks for having me on your show today. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Yes, as you mentioned, Shriners Children's Twin Cities is celebrating our 100th anniversary. We have been providing specialty orthopedic care to kids since March 12th, 1923, which is pretty amazing for an organization to have lasted 100 years. It's all thanks to the wondrous donations and contributions that we've received over those many years. And we are going to gather on Friday, June 2nd, as you mentioned, at the Depot in Minneapolis to celebrate our 100th anniversary with our Imagine, Believe, Achieve signature fundraising event. We started this event in 2016, and over the course of the last 8 years, we have raised $1.5 million with this event. And so we're really excited to be able to bring all of our donors and friends and patient families and former patients together and just have a wonderful evening celebrating the work of Shriners Children's.
And our operation in the Twin Cities is the only one to have a woman's auxiliary operation left in it. I'm pretty pleased with that too, because they're doing such great things now.
Yeah, the WGA for Kids also is celebrating their 100th anniversary, and that's been really wonderful to have that group support us for as long as they have. We really appreciate all that they do to make sure that kids are well taken care of. They have the adaptive equipment and wheelchairs that they need to be able to live fulfilling lives. So we appreciate their support.
There's different programs you do in the summertime for kids too that you might want to expound on.
Yeah, so any patient is welcome to join us through our camp program. We offer different events throughout the summer, actually throughout the year for kids, whether it be a day camp for acting or our Camp Achieve, which is for kids that have limb deficiencies. We're gathering kids that have similar diagnoses and being able to forge lifelong relationships and offer activities and events that they might not be able to participate in otherwise. We have partnered with a water skiing group in Shakopee, Shockwaves, and we've been able to take kids water skiing. That's something that you might think that a kid that has a prosthetic or a kid that uses a wheelchair might not be able to participate in, but we've been able to partner with this group and have lots of kids come out and try activities like that, and it's been really fun to watch that.
Great.
So those kids be able to participate.
So as far as your position there at Toronto Children's, what do you find is the most effective to accomplish your goal and what you do, is whether it be raising funds or planning an event, or what is the most effective thing for you?
You know, just to spread the word, create awareness. You know, my role is to raise friends and raise funds. And so it's really important for people to understand what Shriners does, you know, that we help kids with anything to do with bones, muscles, or joints. So whereas adults might go see an orthopedic doctor for, you know, an injury or something, that a chronic condition, you know, maybe they have an issue with your hip as you get older.
Oh yes.
Our hips start to hurt.
And then we also do athletic stuff too over there.
Absolutely.
Now.
Yes. And, yep. Anything that helps kids with bones, muscles, or joints, we can support.
And so I'm getting down to about the final two questions. This interview went by just like that. Is there anything that you'd like to say or anything that I might have missed?
Well, I just want to invite people to continue to learn about what Shriners Children's does. You know, there's never a need for a referral from a physician or other medical provider for kids to come and be seen here at Shriners Children's for a condition that's related to orthopedics. So please, you know, we thank you for all of your continued support, and please find out, you know, feel free to go onto our website and find about more ways that you can get involved in supporting Shriners Children's.
Yeah, and every other Shrine affiliate across the country, I hate to hear me say this, but the Twin Cities does lead the way. Whether anybody else wants to admit that or not, we really do lead the way. We have a woman's auxiliary, and we have you in your position that does a great job. Lauren Elm, David Voller is our administrator, and it's just, I can't say enough good things. And I got the proof because I was once one, a patient there. So there you go.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Mark.
Thanks to Jennifer Sutch from Shriners Children's in Woodbury, Minnesota, for being with us today, and we'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a second. Thanks, Jennifer.
Thanks, Mark.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. We had a great show today. I'd like to thank Holly Kampa from Highland Friendship Club for coming on. Mark, do you have any final words?
Well, I'm speechless, really. But we had Jennifer Sutch on from Shriners Children's. Shriners just celebrated their 100th anniversary, and they have a Believe and Achieve dinner on June 2nd down at the Depot in Minneapolis. Everyone is welcome to attend. If you'd like to purchase a table, you can call 612-596-6100. Again, 612-596-6100. Just ask for Jennifer Sutch and she'll hook you up. And we talked about the 100th anniversary of Shriners Children's Hospital and all the good works they've done. And then we had Trevor Turner to do the legislative update from the Minnesota Council on Disabilities. And he had a whole bunch of great things to say, and he'll be on with us again on our next show because we'll do a legislative update again. So we hope you keep watching Disability Viewpoints, which is in its 25th year. And for our entire team, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching. And again, thanks to Nick Wilkie from the Metropolitan Center for Independent Living. And we'll talk to you soon. Bye for now.
Thanks, everybody.